So that's what I'm going to talk about. And so this experiment, we did it in HSVA in 2012 in cooperation with NTNU, and we had some help from STOIL. And so I'm from Multiconsult. Then in this presentation, I will first make a brief introduction of why we are studying the ice action structure. And then I present the test setup, and then I go to results with video observation and load analysis. And at the end, I will present the conclusion. So when you have a level ice interacting with a structure, so of course the ice will break on the structure, and this ice breaking will produce a part of the load. But also you will create accumulation of ice blocks on the structure and under the level ice, which is
impacting the structure. And this rubble, it will influence the ice action on the structure. And therefore, you have to study this rubble accumulation and transport. So that's what I say here. A correct estimation of the subsurface rubble accumulation is necessary for determination of the ice load level. So there has been some past studies on ice action on floating structures, and they have shown that it depends on the rubble accumulation process. But there has not been any rigorous analysis of the rubble accumulation process, which combine both physical and numerical analysis. And therefore, it's still necessary to determine the mechanism of rubble transport to analyze and estimate the rubble effect on the ice load. So the golden scope of the study, the goal was to investigate the global and local ice action on the structure in relation to rubble accumulation and transport, and also in relation to the properties of this rubble accumulation. And of course, we could also vary the ice parameters and study the effect on both the rubble accumulation and the ice load. So what we did, we pushed two structures through level ice, and we were varying the width of the structure, the incidence, so if it's impacting at 0 degrees or 45 degrees and so on. And we were also changing the ice properties. And we monitored the ice load at the waterline, and also the ice load below the waterline. So typically, it's a load from the river accumulation. And we also monitored the transport and the accumulation of the subsurface river with video observation. On this work, we did it in two types of structure. One, which was causing a 3D, three-dimensional failure and transport of the ice. And the second structure, which was causing a two-dimensional failure of the ice. And we also studied the physical and mechanical properties of the subsurface rubble. So here you can see a picture of the three-dimensional structure we used. So this part here was at the waterline, and you can see it's inclined. It represents, for example, the side of a vessel with an ice belt. And the inclination was 45 degrees. And the width of one of the structures was 1.2 meters. And the structures, you can see they could be separated like this with a 1 meter gap in between or joined. And then it makes you have you can double the width of the structure. And also, if you see from above, you can see that it could rotate. So we could place in this configuration, 0 degree ice incident. Or in this configuration, for example, but here it's a 45 degree ice incident. And also different angle in between. So here you see a picture showing underwater picture showing the structure in water. The ice will come from this direction. So then it will break look at the load measurement system, we had three different panels. So over there, you have the first load panel, which is at the waterline, and it was measuring the load from the ice breaking. And then we had a small panel, which was under the waterline, and then we had a vertical panel, which was measuring the rubber load. And we had underwater video camera for measuring, for monitoring the rubber transport and the ice breaking pattern. And the ice breaking pattern, you can see it here, for example, where when the ice is coming against the structure, you have some cracks forming. And this is the second structure we were tested, so that's a two-dimensional structure. It's we call it buoyancy box. The back of the box here has the same profile of three-dimensional structure, so inclined panel of the waterline. But the difference is that we limit the extent of the failure zone by two vertical walls, which are transparent. And then when you have a video camera on the side, we can observe how the rubble will, how the ice will break and how the rubble accumulate into the box. So what we did with this box was to lower it into the water, and the ice was could impact on the inclined panel, and then we pushed the box through the ice. So here you can see a side drawing of this box. So you see the ice is coming from here, here, and then it will break from this and accumulate. So we were also measuring the load in the buoyancy box, but we had a different setup that will be presented in more detail in the next presentation by Renjun. And in this setup, we use a tactile sensor to measure the dynamic and temporal variation of the ice load over the entire surface of this sensor. For the sensor, it was placed on the inclined panel at the waterline. So this is our test matrix for the ice properties. So we had five different ice sheets. We had one first ice sheet which we considered as our base case. And then we were changing the velocity of the ice, which was increased to 0.2 meters per second. We changed the density of the ice, which was reduced. And we changed the ice thickness and Young modulus. And we changed the Young modulus in the last ice sheet. That's some snapshots of the underwater videos from the ice breaking process and the three-dimensional structure. So we could see that the ice was coming against the structure, which is now inclined with 15 or 30 degrees for the ice incidence. Then it was breaking downward and sliding downward, and then the blocks were going upward and accumulating like that. And we could observe that there was a circular rubble motion, so this process was continuous. It was not a static rubble accumulation, but always in rotation. And the same mechanism was observed in the buoyancy box. So first, you have bending value of the level ice, and you could also observe some secondary breaking of the ice block, and even third breaking at the intersection between inclined part and vertical part. And then the ice block was sliding downward and breaking up here, and it was lifted up. And again, we were observing the same rotation motion. And what we observed also is that the rubble accumulation was increasing in volume and then collapsing at some point, and this was a cyclic process repeating itself. So we now relate these observations to the equation which is presented in ISO standards, for example, to describe the ice load on inclined structure. So if we remember this equation, it's based on a Crossdale model, and it's transposed in these five components. The first component, HV, is the breaking load, so the load you get when just because of the breaking of the ice on the structure. Then you have HP, which is the load component required to push the ice sheet through the ice rubble. So that's when you have rubble accumulation of the ice sheet is coming like this. So this creates, the rubble creates friction on this ice sheet. And this transmits the load from the ice sheet through the rubble to the structure. And this is HP. Then you have HR, which is the load to push the ice blocks along the slope, downward, and through the ice rubble. So it's due to the buoyancy of the rubble and the pressure from this rubble against the ice sheet, which is now sliding downward against the structure. And then HL, that's the load which is required to lift the rubble on top of the advancing ice sheet prior to breaking it. It means simply that when you break this ice sheet, when you push it downward, you also have to push downward the entire rubble accumulation, according to this equation. And then this component here is overturning of the blocks when they reach the vertical part. So then the difference between this equation and what we observe in the buoyancy box is that this term doesn't, we don't find it, because to get this term into the static rubble accumulation, but we have rotation. On this term here, the load component from overturning, we observe that it was depending on the rubble volume. And finally, this term here, HB, which is the breaking load, we observe that it was changing. When you have more rubble accumulation, you have a shorter breaking length on the ice blocks, and that will influence the ice load. And now if we look at the load time series from the three-dimensional structure, we could observe that the water-like ice load was always increasing, and then pretty fast it was reaching a steady state, while the rubble load, it was increasing, but it took a lot more time to reach a steady state. And you can see it here also, if you have the ice incidence here and the time to steady state, all the crosses, it shows the time to steady state for the rubble ice load, and this is for the waterline ice load. This is the circle. And in all the configuration, we could see that the waterline ice load steady state was reached always before the rubble ice load steady state. So what it means is that there is influence from the rubble accumulation on the waterline ice load, but it's limited to a maximum waterline ice load. You could increase the waterline ice load at the beginning, but you could not increase it above a certain limit. When it comes now to the parametric study, where we were in the ice density, ice thickness, on the Young modulus only, we could, if you have the ice incidence here, and then the ice load, here the waterline ice load, and here the rubble load, we could observe that there was decreasing load for increasing incidence. And the important effect on the ice density on the waterline ice load, as you see, the low ice density made higher loads. And there was increased rubble buoyancy, it was increasing the rubble load. You can see it here.
And you cannot cut.
Everything is flat. So in conclusion, we can say that the accumulation of subsurface rubble, it contributes to an increase of the ice breaking load, but this increase is limited. And the waterline ice load, it's not necessarily higher. the larger rubble accumulation, it will contribute to larger rubble load, of course. And so we observe a circular rubble motion, which is not always considered in the calculation method. And both the ice breaking load and the rubble ice load are the most sensitive to the ice density or to the buoyancy from this rubble. And so the final conclusion is that some of our observations are not in accordance with the model for the rubble ice action. So ice breaking at several places during the sliding of the ice blocks, continuous rotation from the rubble accumulation, of the decreasing porosity for increasing buoyancy of the rubble accumulation. And you can get more details on that on the 2 white papers that I have submitted last year and the other 5 papers related to the experiment. So I would like to thank all the participants who helped in the ice tank and the different institutes who helped to provide the possibility to do this experiment. And of course, I don't know the project member, thank you, but thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we have still short time for at least one question or maybe two. When the answer is short, any questions? Over to Rias.
Thank you. Thank you. That was interesting, Nicholas. It's what about the ISO prediction load? Is that getting quite too conservative in view of your experiment?
Okay, now it looks like in your presentation this rotating component is the one that differs mostly in ISO model, because ISO is intended for conical structure that's infinite width, and this circular shape makes that ice can bypass on both sides much easier. But in your model, this rotation continues. If you have infinite width of the structure and infinite length of the ice coming, so this rotation will be infinitely large. So I think this must have some natural boundary.